So this is going to be a clinical demonstration of the liver. I'm holding the eviscerated liver in front of me to bring up to speed. This is anatomical right lobe, anatomical left lobe. This membranous structure that you see here, this is the falciform ligament. And attached to the free margin of the falciform ligament is this round ligament of liver. Let's talk about the peritoneal spaces around the liver. This is under the right dome of the diaphragm. So between the right dome of the diaphragm and the liver, we have this space where my hand is located. This is referred to as the subphrenic rhesus. This subphrenic rhesus communicates with the general peritoneal cavity, and it is divided into two halves, right and a left half, by this falciform ligament. The next space that we have is on the visceral surface of the liver, where my hand is located. This is known as the subhepatic space. And if I were to push my finger beyond the subhepatic space where my hand is going right now, then it goes into yet another deep rhesus, and that is known as the hepatorenal rhesus. This is a very special rhesus. It is also called the Morrison pouch. And this is located between the right anatomical lobe of the liver and the right kidney. This is one of the two most dependent parts of the peritoneal cavity when there is a peritoneal fluid. The other dependent part being the pelvis. So what is the clinical significance of these three spaces? Whenever there is excess fluid in the peritoneal cavity or pus collection, they tend to collect here, and then they tend to gravitate into the hepatorenal rhesus, and from there they gravitate along the paracolic gutters and they collect into the pelvis. Not only that, after surgery, if there's any collection of blood, they tend to collect in these spaces. Now let's come to some interventions on the liver itself. Most of the liver is located in the right hypochondrium. So the extent of the liver is from the 7th to the 11th ribs. When we have to do a liver puncture, an ultrasound or a CT scan guided liver puncture, of course, previous to that, we have to do prothrombin time and international normalized ratio. And after that, when it is normal, only then we can do a liver puncture. We should do it in the 9th intercostal space, in the mid-axillary line. And we must remember that the Glisson's capsule is painful. We can use the same procedure for taking a liver biopsy. Earlier days, they used to use a Wim Silberman needle. Nowadays, they use Chiba needle, which has been designed by the Chiba University of Japan. Now let's come to some other aspects. This is the porta hepatis. The porta hepatis is not covered by peritoneum, so only the margins of the porta hepatis are lined by the peritoneum. So what are the three structures which are entering or leaving the porta hepatis? First, we have this structure here. This is the common bile duct. Next structure we have is the hepatic artery. And the third structure we have is the portal vein. So these three structures together constitute extrahepatic portal triad. So here we have several important clinical correlations. I have held up the three structures of the extrahepatic portal triad in my instrument here. These three structures are running in double fold of peritoneum, referred to as the hepatoduodenal ligament, which attaches itself to the first part of the duodenum. When we are doing a liver surgery, if there's bleeding from the hepatic artery or from the cystic artery and we cannot control the blood and the whole area gets filled with blood, we can do what is known as a Pringle's maneuver, and that is exactly what I have done with my finger. I have put two of my fingers behind the extrahepatic portal triad into the epiploic foramen. My thumb is in front and it is compressing the structures of the portal triad. And by so doing, I can compress the hepatic artery, and then we can stop the bleeding. And then we can look for the source of bleeding, and then we can ligate it. This is a very useful and a life-saving procedure for the surgeon as well as for the patient, and that is known as Pringle maneuver. Now let's quickly look at some of the other structures in the portal triad. As I mentioned, this is the common bile duct. In this particular cadaver, she has already undergone cholecystectomy. And if you look very closely, you can see that the cystic duct, there's a clip here. So this is the remnant of the cystic duct. And if we trace the common bile duct, we notice that it is dividing into a right hepatic duct and a left hepatic duct. We can get a special type of cholangiocarcinoma, where the cholangiocarcinoma involves a bifurcation between the two hepatic ducts, and that is referred to as Klatskin tumor. Cholangiocarcinoma occurs when there is a asiatic cholangiohepatitis or long-standing inflammation or due to some parasitic inflammations. Then there is a condition which is referred to as congenital biliary atresia, where the whole biliary system is atretic at newborn itself. Only dilated portions are the intrahepatic biliary radicals, and those are used in the porta hepatis to anastomose with the jejunum, and that is referred to as hepaticojejunostomy, and that procedure is also referred to as Kasai operation. Now let's come to portal vein here. The portal vein, as it goes inside the porta hepatis, again we can see it is dividing into a right branch and a left branch. This left branch of the portal vein communicates with para-umbilical veins. To show you the para-umbilical veins, let me just turn the liver again. Come back to the falciform ligament. This is the falciform ligament. And as I said, the falciform ligament has got the round ligament in its free margin. The round ligament is the fibrous remnant of the umbilical vein, which carried oxygenated blood in the fetal life. If you look closely, we can see some small venous channels here. These are referred to as the para-umbilical veins, which are present in adults. These para-umbilical veins run with the round ligament of liver and they open into the left branch of the portal vein. Proximally, they communicate with the veins around the umbilicus. This is the umbilicus. The veins around the umbilicus are tributaries of the superficial epigastric vein, which drains into the femoral vein. So therefore, para-umbilical veins are a source of porta-systemic communication. In a patient with cirrhosis with portal hypertension, these para-umbilical veins can become engorged with blood because of reversal of flow. And the patient can present with dilated superficial epigastric veins around the umbilicus, which will radiate out around the umbilicus in a radial fashion. And that is a clinical sign, cirrhosis, and that is referred to as caput medusa. So that is the significance of the left branch of the portal vein communicating with the para-umbilical veins. Now let me show you the hepatic artery itself. This is the hepatic artery. And if you were to look closely, we notice that the hepatic artery is making a sharp right angle bend here. This portion of the hepatic artery is coming from the celiac trunk. So this is the celiac trunk which I have lifted up here. We have completely removed all the celiac plexus around here. And we can see three branches coming out from the celiac trunk. The largest branch, of course, is the splenic artery, which is highly tortuous. And the second largest branch, this is the common hepatic artery. And this is the left gastric artery. This common hepatic artery runs to the right. This is the other end of the common hepatic artery that we see here. And then it makes a right angle bend. At the place where it makes a bend, it gives up this branch here. This is the gastroduodenal artery. This gastroduodenal artery runs behind the first part of the duodenum. And this gastroduodenal artery can be a source of bleeding in a posterior duodenal ulcer. After it makes a bend, then the rest of the hepatic artery, which we see here, is referred to as hepatic artery proper. From the hepatic artery proper, we have this another branch coming out here. This is the right gastric artery. The hepatic artery proper ideally is supposed to divide into a right hepatic artery and a left hepatic artery. But here we can see 1, 2, 3. And from the right hepatic artery is supposed to arise the cystic artery, which runs in the cholecystohepatic triangle of Calot and supplies the gallbladder. But again, as I mentioned, in this particular cadaver, the gallbladder has been removed. So therefore, this is the stump of the cystic artery. And we can see the clip is attached here. So therefore, we have seen two clips. We have seen the clip of the cystic duct here, and we can see the clip of the cystic artery here. This is the fossa for the gallbladder. So therefore, when we do cholecystectomy, we are operating in this region that is called the cholecystohepatic triangle of Calot. This triangle is bounded by the liver above and the common hepatic duct. And the content of this triangle is cystic artery, which I showed you just now, and the cystic lymph node. So these are some of the clinical aspects of the liver that I wanted to mention to you. Thank you very much for watching. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. Dr. Gomattie Chunilall is the camera person. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Have a nice day.